Our program is called Small Home, Big Impact. It's an accessory dwelling units workshop. And my name is Vianney Nava. I'm the ADU program manager for the Housing Trust. We're a CDFI. We're a community development financial institution. And basically, in short, we're a lender. And our mission is to create affordable housing in the Bay Area. And now we're trying to help homeowners develop accessory dwelling units. We have our ADU practitioners here, and I'll let each of you introduce yourselves if you don't mind.
My name is Rebecca Gallardo, and I'm with Entero Real Estate Services, and I've been in real estate for over 25 years, and I have also I also do property management. It's not exactly my favorite thing to do because it is challenging, but it's doable. So I'll be doing the presentation on property management, and I look forward to giving you some insights. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Steve Leos. I'm with Prefab ADU. We're an ADU builder based out of Everett, California. We've been building ADUs for about 13 years, and happy to be here and share information with you.
I'm Pam. My name's Pam Dorn, and I work for a nonprofit called Soup, and we build ADUs in backyards. We also build clusters of ADUs or small homes on big properties to help more people. So that's kind of the thing that we're doing. And we kind of specialize in modular or prefab factory-built housing to make it a little simpler to get it into your backyard. And we also specialize in walking a homeowner through the whole process, kind of as a project manager, because it can be pretty complex and difficult for some of us in different jurisdictions, except San Jose.
And my name is Brad Gunkel with Gunkel Architecture. We are a Berkeley-based architecture firm that we do ADUs all around the Bay Area.
I'm going to have Brad come up and talk about what is an ADU. I think probably cover, but we're still going to go ahead and do that.
An accessory dwelling is basically just that. It's accessory to the primary residence. In most jurisdictions, an accessory dwelling is not allowed to be rented out separately or sold off separately from the main dwelling. And in many jurisdictions, the cities, counties, etc., will actually require a deed restriction preventing it from being sold off separately. They'll often also require some kind of a deed restriction or other legal agreement that the owner will live on the site, either in the primary dwelling or the accessory dwelling. This is changing in some jurisdictions, but this is still the norm in most. And so the accessory term is really taken to heart in most jurisdictions. Accessory dwellings are used for many different purposes. Sometimes they're for a family member, sometimes they're for the property owner who wants to move into the accessory dwelling and then house their children or allow their children to live in the primary dwelling, use the accessory dwelling as a place to live during retirement, etc. It is often used as rental income, and a lot of times there are a number of uses anticipated for the accessory dwelling with a desire for flexibility. So it could be, rental income for a while, and then my parents might move into it. And accessory dwellings, as probably, many of you are familiar with, take a number of different forms. And that can be an attached accessory dwelling, a detached accessory dwelling, an accessory dwelling over a garage. It can be a garage conversion, and some other creative forms as well. And each form has its pluses and minuses. So as you're thinking about the best approach to creating an accessory dwelling on your own property, it's important to think about the pluses and minuses of the various forms. And probably the best way to think about that is to start by asking yourself, what elements of your existing property do you want to preserve? And which elements of your existing property are maybe not as important to you? as an example, is your yard important to you? Do you have small children? You want to make sure that you can maintain a yard where they can play. Is privacy a primary of primary importance to you? If you're going to be renting this out, are you going to be looking, you know, do you really want to be seeing this person or people who are renting that accessory dwelling, you know, coming in and out of it, etc.? How important is parking on your property and having covered parking? You know, so as you can imagine, each form or each structural form has its pluses and minuses. So, you know, if you think about an attached accessory dwelling, is going to, you know, it might be able, you might be able to preserve more of your yard with an attached accessory dwelling, but at the same time, it might be more difficult to maintain the level of privacy that you're looking for in an accessory dwelling. You know, even income is, you know, plays a role in the creation of the accessory dwelling, the decision on how, on what form that takes. So if you are looking to maximize your investment in the construction of an accessory dwelling, you might want to consider a detached accessory dwelling, in that many people sort of view a detached accessory dwelling, a renter or a potential renter might view an accessory, a detached accessory dwelling, as more of a little house. Whereas if they're climbing up an exterior stair to go into an accessory dwelling that's in your attic, or going to an accessory dwelling that's in your basement, in those cases, you may, you know, of course, in this current climate, you're going to get good rent one way or the other, but you're probably not going to maximize your investment if you're doing an attached accessory dwelling, or one that's within the envelope of your existing home. Let's see here. So just kind of going through the forms real quickly and the pluses and minuses of each. So the attached, you know, as I mentioned, it can be good for, especially good for family members if you're looking to have the flexibility of an accessory dwelling, but actually have the ability to go from one to the other. That said, certain jurisdictions are actually not allowing doors between accessory dwellings and homes in when they're attached. So you'll need to investigate that. They're good for flexibility in many cases. So if you're not sure that you're going to be using it for family members or rental, or maybe just an extension of your home at certain times, maybe you might want to rent it out at some times and other times have it as an office extension of your house. That can be a great opportunity. Some, you know, drawbacks of an attached accessory dwelling is if it's attached, it's basically taking over a portion of a wall or area of your existing house exterior surface area. And so certain windows might end up getting blocked. It may, you know, impact your solar gain for your existing home.
I'll talk a little bit about prefab so that I can help people understand what it is. The term prefab is somewhat generic. It pretty much covers anything that can fit underneath that umbrella, and essentially anything that isn't conventional site building. So if we're looking at the dynamics of the two, conventional site building and then prefab. Conventional site building would be your traditional lumber drop at the site. Everything is erected from scratch right there on the property. The next form up from that would be panelized construction, where the walls are pre-built at a factory and then they're delivered to the site and then they're tilted up. The roof may be a panel as well, or it may be trusses, and the structure is then enclosed, and then all of the interior finishes, exterior finishes are done on site. There are other methods that we don't particularly use, but they're things called SIPs, structurally insulated panels. That's basically, it's like a giant piece of foam with two pieces of plywood glued to it on the exterior. There's ICFs, which are concrete forms. And then we move up to the next category in prefab, which would be like a manufactured home or a modular home. And those are essentially somewhere in the neighborhood of like 80 to 90% complete in a factory, delivered to the site, kind of like what you're seeing here. And then placed on the foundation. So, but all of these products fall under the umbrella of what we call prefab. So you'll hear prefab being used as a term for any of these things. So sometimes that confuses people because I get the question, well, I thought panelized was prefab, but you're saying modular is prefab. Well, yeah, they all are essentially under that umbrella. So does that make sense? So we personally work with manufactured modular and the panelized products. And you know, our philosophy of how to approach this is basically we're not pitching a product as much as we're trying to determine what is the best solution for you. Each customer scenario is different. So it isn't a scenario where, because I get this question a lot, well, which one's better? There is really no better in terms of one product, one method or the other. It's really what's better for you.
So I'm going to talk a little bit about selecting a designer or an architect to help you in the creation of your accessory dwelling. So I'm an architect. One of the first things I should make sure you're aware of is that you do not need an architect to create an accessory dwelling. In fact, in the state of California, you don't need an architect to create a fourplex of townhomes if you want. And so there are designers out there who, some are civil engineers or structural engineers, others come from construction backgrounds, et cetera, who you can hire to design an accessory dwelling for yourself as well. If you want to put enough energy and time into it, you could design it yourself. That all said, obviously, you know, accessory dwellings are not rocket science, but at the same time, it's a big investment. It's a lot of time, money, and not something that you want to make significant mistakes on. And so in selecting an architect or a designer, it's important to do your due diligence. And what that really comes down to is, does this person or people or firm have experience doing accessory dwellings, ideally in this particular jurisdiction? Have, you know, how much experience? Was it good experience? Through the process, it's important to basically do your homework, do your research. And so ask those who you are considering working with for references. They may be coming to you because you already know of work that they've done. Maybe they did work for you, or for a neighbor or a friend, and you know they did a good job. But that was one particular project. And so ask for references, contact references, possibly ask, see if you can visit projects that they've done and go, you know, so that you can actually see their workmanship. Stepping back again just a little bit, you know, in this profession, so, and you know, if you're hiring an architect's gone through, you know, between schooling and professional experience, has got at least 8 years of experience, and they have gone through a rigorous testing process, whereas a non-licensed architect has not necessarily gone through that, though some might be licensed structural engineers or civil engineers or contractors. But in any case, you know, it's important to do your due diligence in selecting that design professional. So there are a number of different ways in which you can kind of at least initially do outreach to try to find a design professional. Some of them are listed here. So there's Yelp, there's Houzz, H-O-U-Z-Z, which is a lot of eye candy, great place to look for inspiration. So if you're looking to, I mean, in fact, I often, one of the first things I'll do in working with someone is they'll ask me, well, what can I do while you're doing such and such? And I'll say, well, you can start looking on Houzz or Pinterest and finding inspiration, putting together some images that that give you, you know, can communicate the things that you like and are excited by. But most of those Pinterest and Houzz pages, they also have links to the designer that was responsible for those. So you can then click on it, find out who did it. You know, oh, they're in, you know, Texas. Maybe that won't work. But nonetheless, it is one opportunity. There's Home Advisor. There are a lot of these sites that connect homeowners with architects or designers for projects in a specific area. So there's Home Advisors one, there's Bark, there are, you know, plenty. And there is one that I think may maybe we'll be talking about a little bit more later as well, called New Avenue Homes, which is Bay Area specific and specific primarily to accessory dwellings. And so they act as kind of a almost like a virtually assisted design build, in that they have architects, designers, and contractors, and interior designers, all who they've vetted, and they will connect you with an architect or a designer for the design component of it, and then they'll also connect you with the contractor for the construction component. And they also have a really great, very transparent platform where you can track your budget, construction costs, et cetera, through the entire project. So you're not kind of just pulling together different proposals from different, you know, oh, this is what I got from the architect, this is what I got from the structural engineer, this is what I got from the contractor, et cetera, and trying to add it all up in your own Excel spreadsheet. Mm-hmm. And so so that's a really great, that's a really great platform. Obviously, if you've seen accessory dwellings built in the area that you like, and you know, asking those neighbors who did that design, and talking to that individual as well. Let's see here. Yeah, you know, and I guess one of the things to keep in mind in selecting a designer or architect, I mean, I would recommend, you know, reaching out to one or, you know, to more than just one if possible, just so that you're getting proposals or bids that are that you can compare, and so that you know what kind of target, you know that you're in the right ballpark. I've seen projects where people have reached out to only one individual and ended up with paying fees that were, you know, exorbitant because they didn't really have the ability to compare apples to apples or have an understanding in the market. And so I think that's always important. At the same time, you're probably not just shopping for fees. And I'm guessing in many cases, you're also looking for design, looking for someone who's a good communicator, someone who can help translate what's in your mind and your plans to paper and then into the built environment. And so that's all really important as well. And I think it's, you know, one thing to keep in mind when you are, meeting with and getting proposals from design professionals is that the profit margin in the design and architecture field is pretty minimal. It's very low. Oftentimes when you're getting proposals, there's not a lot of room for negotiation on the part of the designer. And so that's something to keep in mind as well. So now we're going to talk a little bit about the permitting process. So this is the process of getting from having a design that you're working through with a designer and getting that permitted through the city. I should start by saying that even when you are working with the designer on the preliminary design, that designer should be, and in most cases will be, doing their due diligence as well with the city. And so in many cases, if they know, you know, if they've done other accessory dwellings in your jurisdiction, they're familiar with the current zoning requirements and build and how building code is and other requirements are being interpreted, they may feel relatively comfortable in just moving forward without meeting with city staff. And in some cases, that may, you know, there's really no reason for them to meet with city staff. But that said, the requirements in most jurisdictions in the Bay Area are constantly changing. And so if a design professional is working regularly in a specific area, they will probably be familiar with the changes. They'll be some of them will be on panels like this. Some of them will be meeting with city staff regularly to try to to understand what the changes are coming up might be, because sometimes you'll actually want to know what upcoming changes are coming down the path because they may benefit you. I mean, we've certainly had a number of projects where someone wanted to do something that they couldn't do at the time, but I knew that, you know, something that the Planning Commission, Planning, or City Council are considering revisions that will actually help them out. And so I've advised them to, you know, if they really want to do that specific thing, they may want to hold off for, you know, 6 months or a year, whatever the timeline might be for those revisions to actually occur. If you are doing something a little bit out of the ordinary, pushing the envelope, in many cases, then the design professional will actually want to meet with city staff after you have, sometimes even from the very beginning. So if you've got a project right now where it's an L-shaped lot, very strange and hard to predict, how the planning department would view setbacks. And so met with the city before we even started on the design. But if there are some questions, you may want to start moving through the design process and then meet with the city. But that said, it's not always going to be a case where you do everything behind the scenes and then go into the city. Oftentimes, there's a conversation occurring with city staff from a pretty early stage. So now I want to kind of get into the actual submittal process. A lot of jurisdictions, and you're probably aware of this, have created a streamlined review process for accessory dwellings if they fit within certain parameters. And so you've learned a little bit about San Jose's, but every city pretty much now has, or you know, does in California have, because of they're required to have, a process that's relatively streamlined, provided your design fits within certain parameters. In those cases, you do not need a separate design review, or you don't need a separate set of design review documents necessarily. And what I'm gonna differentiate the two. So if you're designing, say, a new house that requires planning review and building department review, oftentimes you will take your design to a certain place figuratively, meaning that it might be a relatively schematic design at that point, and you will submit it to the planning department. The reason that you're basically submitting it to the planning department so that they can review it and confirm that you're meeting with the zoning requirements and any design review guidelines. And so the trick is you don't necessarily want to go too far down the path of designing the house. You don't want to know where every outlet is. You don't want to know what the rebar spacing is in the foundation when there's a decent chance that the city, the planning department, may require you to make revisions to the design. And so the trick with accessory dwellings is determining whether or not you really are falling within the streamlined review process parameters. And you know, if you are not, if there's something that you want to do that puts you outside the streamlined review parameters, then you will go through a separate design review process in that you will create a schematic design with floor plans, elevations, site plan, etc., but not really get into the nuts and bolts of how the building is built. And you will submit it to planning, and then they will go through their review process. And depending on the jurisdiction and where you're kind of pushing beyond the base zoning and the base zoning allowances for accessory dwellings, it could even be something where you have to go before go to a public hearing. If you're staying within the guidelines for the streamlined review process, however, then you don't necessarily want to have a separate or this sort of benchmark or along the way where you're submitting a separate set of documents. In most cases, if we're doing this kind of streamlined review process for an accessory dwelling, we will be moving all the way through to a building permit set of drawings before submitting. And that is because we know the requirements of the city, we're comfortable in that we are meeting those, and we will, and there's really no reason to be submitting something this sort of this sort of intermediate set of drawings to the city for their review. In fact, in most jurisdictions through the streamlined review process, you can either submit directly to the building department and they will channel it to the planning department, or you can do an over-the-counter review with the planning department the very same day that you submit to the building department. What that means, though, is that you're not submitting the drawings until you've actually worked out all the little details. And so just to kind of give you, to step back and give you a little bit more detail, a little more information on the sort of differentiation that I'm making here, the selection of finished materials as far as exterior finished materials are something that the planning department concerns themselves with, but the location of an outlet within your house or the locations of the lighting within your house, et cetera, are not things that the planning department will concern themselves with. The planning department is concerned with how your house is impacting the surrounding area, the neighborhood. And so they're looking at the appearance of it. They're looking at whether it shades neighbors, whether it is a privacy concern, creates privacy issues with neighbors, whether it creates parking issues on the street. The trick is when you are, as long as you are complying with the sort of streamlined review process guidelines, you can kind of, it's an administrative review on the part of the city, and that is a good thing. If you're trying to move through this process relatively efficiently. And that is because in the Bay Area, everyone's got an opinion, and it's very political. If you're trying to build something on your property, people are afraid of change, and they're afraid of how it's going to impact them. And if you are going outside of those streamlined review parameters, then you are basically making yourself more vulnerable moving through the review process, because you are placing yourself at the you're giving your neighbors leverage, basically. In many cases, once you get outside the streamlined review parameters, you have to get there's a period for neighbor input. Some jurisdictions will actually require you to go around and get signatures from all your neighbors. They'll be notified. You might have a sign in your front yard telling everybody that you're planning on doing this. And that opens up the opportunity for all of your neighbors to come, to decide whether or not they feel like what you're proposing is going to negatively impact them. And so I often recommend that if you can avoid it and still get something pretty close to what you want, it's often better to do that than to go through that process. That said, there are certainly times when it's worth it for parking reasons, for preserving enough of the yard, because you have a strange-shaped lot that doesn't really, I've got a project right now in Burlingame, the lot is a triangle that doesn't have any part of it fronting on a street. And so, I had to wait for the planning department to tell us what they consider the front, side, and rear yards. And I would say none of them made sense based on what I would have come up with, but we're working with it. So that's the distinction that's important to make. If you are doing the streamlined process, then really you move through schematic design and then straight into design development and building permit set with your design professional. And so it's really just steps along the way, and then you submit to the building department planning simultaneously, or do a over-the-counter review with planning and then move into building.
So before I get into this, I want to put the kind of the caveat out here that when we put this together, the idea here is to look at kind of anything and everything that could possibly come up. So by us reviewing this, it doesn't automatically mean that you can, you're 100% assured that all these things are going to be charges to your project. So we'll go through them kind of one by one, and I'll kind of tell you which ones are normal that you would expect, and then things that are very area specific and may or may not be relevant to your project. So, but when you look at a project, oftentimes the first thing that people ask is, you know, what is the construction cost, cost per square foot, and that ultimately ends up being the only thing they're looking at. And so this effort is to help you understand that there are and most likely will be other things that that are part of the overall cost that need to be considered. So oftentimes there is some work that needs to be done on the site before we begin construction. It may be in an area of the yard that there's either debris or there's another structure that has to be demolished. So this figure here at about $2,000 is usually relative to something as a light cleanup cost. If there is an old structure, a shed, or an old dilapidated garage that needs to be tore down, the costs are probably going to be a little bit higher than this $2,000 figure. The 500 square foot detached structure is coming in at $150,000 here. That's obviously what you're after in terms of why we're here to talk, that will be a cost. Appliances, again, varies from contractor to contractor, manufacturer to manufacturer, whether those are going to actually be included in the overall cost, so it's important to ask. Some of the projects that we do, there is a standard inclusion for appliances, but oftentimes contractors don't include appliances. So it's important to ask, and then ask what types of appliances. Sometimes when they say appliances are included, it's going to be maybe something simple as the range and a garbage disposal. When in your mind you're thinking range, dishwasher, microwave, refrigerator, washer and dryer. So it's important to understand and level set between who and yourself and whoever you're working with as to what what is in your contract and what your expectations are. Fire sprinklers used to be required on every single project, but now they're only required on projects where on a detached unit if the primary residence has fire sprinklers on the property, then you will be required to put fire sprinklers in the ADU as well. So if you don't have fire sprinklers on your house right now, chances are that fire sprinklers are not going to be required on the new ADU. Design fees, this is in here at $10,000, but a cost can be, all over the place. It really depends on whether you're going with a canned prefab solution or whether you're just tapping into that creative soul and have found a architect who's willing to try and take all that interpretation right out of your head and turn it into something really truly amazing, and that usually has a little bit more cost attached to it. Construction administration, I don't know that necessarily $500 would cover this if it's outside your contractor, but if it's something within your contractor and they're, they may have a light additional administrative or reporting cost. This would be, more on the lower end of things.
Steve, can you clarify what construction administration is?
Construction administration can essentially be some third-party entity that is a liaison, if you will, between the homeowner and the contractor, and they're there to basically ensure that what it is that you're after is being done appropriately. So and it delves into looking at and watching each individual trade. So as the foundation's going in to make sure that's done appropriately, the framing work is done appropriately. So they're watching every aspect of it and making sure that things are done appropriately. They're kind of your eyes and ears for something that you may not have the skill set to make sure that it's being done correctly. So, builder's risk. This is an important piece to the puzzle because there often is a gap between your conventional homeowner's insurance and the insurance that's being provided as the general liability of the contractor. So there are two methods about going about this. You can ask the contractor to roll that into their contract with you. Oftentimes, it's actually a little bit cheaper for you to work it out with your existing homeowners insurance and just put the builder's risk, add that to your policy while the construction is going on. And basically, it gives you kind of that gap coverage, you know, for odd things. If somebody wanders onto your property after hours and managed to hurt themselves on site, the contractor's general liability isn't going to be responsible for that. And your homeowner's insurance may not be if you don't have builder's risk. So it's important to look into this. So that is definitely one of those things that I would definitely tell people, everyone here, to write down and make sure you cover, just so that you don't end up with a, you know, $150,000 or $300,000 or even $500,000 charge to your project that you weren't expecting. Now it gets into the who is going to be my team. Probably one of the first things that people think about is who's going to be my builder. There are people out here who specifically do ADUs, and it's important to search for them, not just search for builders and ask them, hey, you know, can you build an ADU? Because their general answer would be yes, and you will be their experiment project. So, So you may not want to approach it that way. So I suggest you spend a little time and try and qualify this, asking friends and family. There's a lot of information out there on the internet about ADUs now. So generally speaking, it should be pretty easy to find somebody in the Bay Area that knows somebody or can put you in touch with someone. The important things to look for, they should be licensed. Let's start with that one and make sure that we all start with that one. Not just I have a business license in the city you're working with, but actually that they do have a contractor's license. If you're working with a general contractor, you want the general contractor to have a license. How many of you are thinking about approaching this as kind of a do-it-yourselfer project? Anybody? One down here, a couple over there, a few over here. Okay, so chances are you may or may not be working with a general contractor. You may be trying to approach this, and you may, you know, work with a designer or architect to generate a plan set for you, and then the goal may be I got a buddy who does foundations, and you know, my uncle or my cousin does framing, and I have a lot of beer and a barbecue, and you know, we're going to get this thing done. So and that, you know, that's a great way to save money. It's totally a great way to save money and get it done. In those cases, your qualification process is going to be a little different. You're going to have to rely on your own gut instinct in those situations. But outside of that, most of you will be working with probably a general contractor who you would want to oversee the whole project. He or she may be somebody that handles it all in-house, or you may be working together with them to qualify different subcontractors. The process is still the same. You're looking for proper licensing and skills and references, and then also their relative knowledge about building ADUs. These are smaller buildings. They're a big step up from a tough shed, but they're very unique in that they're not, you don't have as much real estate to work with as a primary home. So you want to make sure that they understand all those intricacies. And don't be fooled by the idea that just because the plans are there that any contractor should be able to build it, because that is not necessarily true as well. When you're trying to shove all these things into this tight space, the interior wall space, the interior ceiling space, all these things become very critical in terms of the functional use of the space. Add to that, as you're building, you may have some change of heart about decisions, and you want somebody out there who can give you some good insight to whether the change you're considering is something that you really want to do. So that's going to be a function of your partnership with both your contractor and your architect. So because people change their mind throughout the process. No? None of you? Yeah. Okay. So licensing, that's a big thing. I should mention that you want to verify that they have a license. State has a website, CSLB.com, and you can check their license. And you can see if they've got any violations or claim that it's an active license. You don't want somebody to just show you a card and say, I have a license, and you go on about your day and plan to spend $150,000 with them. Not a bright decision without actually just looking to make sure that their license is actually valid and actually active and that in good standing. So now we've found somebody we're interested in, and we seem to hit it off, and we've had good conversation. And so now the next question comes up is, put some numbers together for me. You should always do some preliminary costs. Brad brought up there's a time almost as soon as plans are drafted, architectural floor plan and elevations. It's a great time to talk to your contractor about budgetary pricing. It's great at that point because you can start doing some real quality level setting on what the general cost would be, and really gives you some opportunity at a very early stage to start delving into, you know, the discussion about what is the anticipated finishes, and you know, both for the exterior and interior. There's a million details to building a home. You want to get them all. You don't want to be in a situation where you're trying to decide on these things after the contract has been written. I guarantee you will have a difference of opinion as to what the quality of the finishes are between what you're expecting and what that contractor is providing if you haven't clearly gone through those things. It all starts with getting that preliminary cost. So get that level set early on. Look at how that works with your budget against that spreadsheet that we showed you. And understand kind of, does this put you in the right place? Because if not, something has to change. Either money's got to come up, quality's got to go down, or size of structure has to go down. Something has to give to make sure that your budget works with your goals. This is an interesting topic. The last line item here is, the designer and the builder should be hired around the same time, and they should form a team. In an ideal world, they were a team when you met them. Most designers have good relationships with contractors, and hence most contractors have good relationships with designers. In an ideal world, you'll pick them and they'll work together because they have worked together in the past. They kind of know how to work with each other, and they know how to, you know, address a client singularly and work as a common towards that common goal. So if you can find that relationship and establish it early, that is important. When you take it as the approach where you're, you know, either you've made the contractor decision ahead of the designer, or you've made the designer decision ahead of the contractor, you want to try and get those things tied up as quickly as possible, because you will need to work with them and they do need to communicate. Because if you're looking at numbers while you're designing, there's a lot of cross-collateralizing the ideas and making sure that all that information leads to a number that works with your budget. So looking at who's on your team, usually a designer or an architect, engineers when they're required, civil, structural, geotech, a surveyor, there's the builder, and there could potentially be an interior designer. It doesn't mean that all these functions are happening with independent resources. Sometimes they're all tied together through one contractual agreement. So it really just depends on who you're working with and what the scope is of their individual function, or whether they have that as a part of the overall team offering that they have. With that, we move into the different types of contracts there are. I'm not going to spend too much time on all of these individually, because really most of the time it really comes down to, you know, a few of them. The lump sum is a fixed fee price. It's basically you give the plans to someone takes them in, they study them, and they get back to you and say, here's our cost to do everything. The cost plus is an odd one. It's not used that much, but it's when you say, I want to go forward with this project, I don't have it all worked out yet, but we'll figure it out as we go. That is hugely beneficial to the contractor usually, so I want you to know how that plays out in terms of the regular roles. So you will probably find a contractor who will say, yes, absolutely, I'll sign up for that, let's go. Time and materials is another one that's kind of a variation on this. It's essentially saying, we don't have everything figured out, so just bill me as you go. That sounds like a good solution for you, right? And then the design build, which is that's like what our organization is. It's essentially saying that, you know, there's one umbrella, and we're going to basically bundle everything underneath that, and we do the whole kind of turnkey thing.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Stancy Camacho Gutierrez, sales manager for Wells Fargo Home Mortgage. Equity lines are an amazing way of financing in certain situations. There's some great benefits to them, including lower payments, the ability to pull as you need. So equity lines are like a huge credit card against your home, right? You only pay on what you use, correct? So that's a huge benefit, especially as you're building an ADU. It might be a good option for you.
Do you have to identify what you use the HELOC for?
When we take the application, yes, you will tell us what the equity line, what the purpose of the equity line is, whether it's cash reserves, home improvements, and so on. Okay. Now, like Brian mentioned, equity lines generally have a variable rate. That's not always true. Generally, banks will offer a fixed rate term on the equity line that you can use to hedge against rising rates. We know that the Feds just raised rates a couple days ago, and they're on track to raise them again and again and again, at least four more times. So you want to be careful with what the ultimate plan there is, right? But home equity lines are definitely an option. You're pulling equity from the home that's already built in, and you're using that to then hopefully create greater equity, okay? In terms of draw periods, equity lines usually have about a 10-year draw period. That means that for 10 years, you're gonna draw and pay. After the 10 years are up, you're going to be required to either refinance or it'll be converted into a 20-year term, fixed rate, fixed interest, that will likely give you a much higher payment than what you're used to, okay? Borrow from retirement accounts. If you have substantial funds in a retirement account and you feel comfortable withdrawing from that, it's an option. Reverse mortgage. Now, I have to say, from my employer, we no longer offer reverse mortgages, but it is an option. There's many lenders out there that will do that for you if you're over a certain age. Reverse mortgages have both kind of an equity feature to it, where it's a line of credit and you could pull as you use, or a fixed rate loan, okay? So it may be an option for you to look at. Construction loans. So construction loans, as I know them, generally means that you're starting with no walls, okay? You're starting from lot. Now, you would have to find a lender who specifically provides construction loans, and then ask whether those construction loans can be used for an ADU. I don't have the answer to that at the moment, but we can definitely look into that and get back to you. Gap or bridge loans. I'm gonna do gap and bridge loans and renovation loans kind of together. Okay, so renovation loans are honestly, quite frankly, maybe a great option. Renovation loans allow you to pull equity from the home at what the future value of the property will be, okay, after improvements. So they will have an appraiser come out, appraise your home as it is, your general contractor will provide an estimate of what the improvements will be, and the appraiser will then provide an estimate of what your value would be after those improvements are completed. Based on that new value after improvements, you'll be able to pull money from your home. Okay, that obviously gives you an advantage, hopefully more equity to be able to pull from. Some of the downside to that is it is going to usually give you a higher interest rate. So it may be an immediate solution, and you'll have to think of how you're going to be able to refinance that later on. Okay.
Yeah, same with the construction loan, it's only very, very short.
Construction loans, bridge loans, renovation loan isn't necessarily short term. You can keep that renovation loan for 30 years if you'd like. It just, you probably wouldn't want to do that if rates are lower and you're able to refinance once the improvements have been completed. Does that make sense? And like you mentioned, gap and bridge loans are short-term loans. They're there. Most lenders will require an exit plan when providing you with a bridge loan. Okay, we'll provide you with this loan. What is the exit plan? Do you plan on selling the property? How will you pay us back? All of that needs to be explained when applying for a bridge loan. Okay. Cash out refinances are very popular, and I've done one for an ADU and in the process of another. Essentially, if you're in a positive equity position, if you have a loan at $400,000 and property values have pushed your value up to $1 million, right, you're going to be able to access 80 to 85% of the value of that home. Of course, based on your income and what that allows. Cash out refinances are a great option for those of you who want something that's fixed, maybe a 30-year term. So you don't have to worry about refinancing later or having that payment increase on you later on. You can build into your budget what the payment is and find out whether that rental income from the ADU is going to be enough to compensate for the additional payment on your mortgage. Does that make sense? And we've also included here refinance first mortgage. Sometimes we just have to lower our monthly expenses to be able to manage this type of project. So maybe it makes sense to refinance your primary mortgage, extend the term, whether it be fixed or variable, depending on what your goals are, and bring the payment into something more comfortable so that you could go ahead and move forward with your project.
So I'm on landlord responsibilities. What are the legal requirements? What is fair housing? Again, my name is Rebecca Gallardo. I'm with Intero Real Estate Services. Well, fair housing from a reasonable standpoint is really the law. And it says to you that you cannot discriminate against people. And it goes on with a lot of legalese. But essentially, you're not supposed to discriminate against people because of their race, their color, their national origin, their religion, their sex, their familial status, or their disability. What you need to know when you're renting out a unit, you have to ask yourself. I have that right here. Things that you need to know when renting out your unit, there's a lot of things to know. So I started as a layman's property manager when I was about 20 years old, and I just fell into it because my parents had property. But I just had to get on. At that time, there wasn't Google. But I had to get a book, go to the library, and start learning what to do. It'll cost you a lot of money if you make mistakes. So I would recommend, if you can find a property manager that's reasonable or feasible, then go ahead and hire a property manager. Otherwise, you're going to have to do some homework and get the right support network around yourself. So what do you need to know when renting out the unit? Well, you need to know that you're the landlord and you have to follow laws, and you have to be able to have showing appointments, show your unit, and take applications and hire a service to do your screening. And that means checking people's credit, criminal history, and employment history, etc. The more you scrub the file, the better tenant you will get. Now, in many cases, you're going to have someone that's in your family who's going to rent it, because that's what I've heard across the board. I wouldn't treat it any differently. I have a nephew in one of my properties. In fact, I'd have a heightened level of sensitivity because, you know, the emotions can get involved. So, and I heard time and time again, it's right next door. So if you're putting it on your property, you know, your tenants have a right to peaceful enjoyment. It's your lease basically says what your obligations are and what their obligations are. And one of the things they have a right to is peaceful enjoyment. So that's a red flag for me if I'm going to have a tenant, you know, right on my same property. Because generally what we have, we rent a house out or we have duplexes, et cetera, and we're not usually living with the tenant. So, and then of course, Nancy pointed out some important features, and that is you do want to have a lease, because let's say you want to do a refinance down the line. You want to have proof that you've had a lease, a bona fide lease, and you've taken a check in and you've made that deposit every single month so that you can actually, appreciate the benefits of having a tenant. So there's a lot to go with the landlord. The tenant responsibilities, they need to pay the rent, and they should pay it on time. And the late fee is very beneficial to getting people to stay on budget and paying the rent on time. And the tenant has to take care of the property. And they also, in the case that you're going to be next to each other or near each other, then they're also going to have to respect that level of peace and enjoyment for you as well. Move out and deposits. I think it's going to go into more of the intricacies of these as we go along. When somebody is going to move out of your property, the law says that they have a right to do a walkthrough 2 weeks prior to their departure. Now, when they do a walk-in, let me move forward. Okay. Fair housing, law, protected classes, do not discriminate. We went over that. Do not discriminate. You all have this handout, and you'll see some of the legalese that says do not advertise in this manner. So when in doubt, leave it out or call your expert to confirm that you can actually say certain things. But you can't say tech workers preferred. You can't say it's in your packet. Couples preferred, looking for female tenants, Christian atmosphere. That's very subjective these days, right? So you just can't say those things. You basically just have to say what you're offering for rent. And everybody has a right to apply, and you cannot deny anyone, any applicant for applying, especially if you put it out in the network, basically, which means you're putting it out probably on social media. Let's see. So that goes over advertising best practices. Call a fair housing counselor at Project Sentinel with questions. So there's different resources that you can use. So there's the Tri-County Apartment Association, and they have a bundle of documents and a bundle of services that they provide for a fee. One of the organizations that's not listed here is the Apartment Owners Association. I use them because they're $100 a year, and it's a well-spent $100. And there's a paralegal that's pretty readily available to answer my questions when I'm in doubt. So whatever service provider you want to use, they will help you. And you want to learn before rather than after so you don't run into any legal problems. City requirements. Depending upon the city, you're required to have a business license, which City of San Jose does require. I'm not sure if they're actually requiring it for the ADUs.
They are.
They are? Okay. It's nominal. I think it's about $100 a year, $150, something like that. And you have to register your unit. Why do we have to do that? We have to do that because there's rent control and there's certain kinds of things that have occurred as a result of the demand for housing. And it just creates additional information that landlords need to provide. Okay, so application. You have to take an application for anyone who asks for it. So if you've advertised the property publicly, then anyone who wants to apply for it, you have to take their application. You're taking money in for a credit check. Generally, I will only take money for the cost of the credit and criminal check and all of that. And that's a good guideline to follow. Now here it says that you're doing the credit check, unlawful detainer judgments. That's a fancy word for you have evicted someone or someone has been evicted and it's on their record. The reason that you really want to scrub the client is because generally when you get to a court of law and you're doing the eviction process, you usually have a mediator and you don't even enter the courtroom and you've got an attorney and someone else representing the tenant that you would like to depart. Or they're fighting for some right, and you want to take possession of your property, you generally will compromise because, as my attorney said, it's your property, you have the money, you have the equity, do you want your house? Yes, I do. So you compromise and you never get into court. So you don't have a record of an unlawful detainer on someone's record. How do you find that out? You really can't unless you really get a hold of the previous landlord and they're willing to tell you, which in many cases they're not, and they're just going to rise above board and say, yep, they paid the rent on time, and yes, they left as we agreed. So as much information as you can get legally, you want to do that. Sufficient income. These days people are paying about 50% of their income on rent. Generally, it used to be that you would expect about 33% of someone's income on rent. But because of the cost of rent and how much it's risen, it's become about 50% as a whole across California. I'm of the adage, and this is maybe neither here nor there because it's really subjective, it's my own opinion. I have a really good tenant, and I have some really good tenants and properties that pay the rent on time and they take care of the property, and I don't raise their rent. I'm okay on where I'm at in terms of my revenue, and in some cases I'm not making any revenue, but it's paying for itself, and I'd rather have someone who's going to pay the rent and who's going to take care of the property. Because the risk is that you raise their rent and then they move, and then you are going to have a cost that is involved to re-rent the property.